program. But before I continue, I am going to tell our viewers and millions of Biafrans watching us today who these great and outstanding men are. We have these are Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's attorneys, both in diaspora here and in Nigeria, where we have attorney at law, our EU representative on extraordinary rendition, Mr. Athanasios Pantazopoulos, a lecturer and the best ever in the city. And we have wise counsel and a special counsel as well, like you all know him, but I call him wise counsel, attorney Aloy Jimako. And we have the man behind the scene, Barrister Mandela Esquire, also Mazi Nnamdi Kanu attorney in Nigeria. And today we are going to discuss about Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's extraordinary rendition. And what and this great mind here is going to let us know and throw more light on what extraordinary rendition is all about. And I'm going to start with attorney at law, Aloy, Mr. Aloy Ejimako. Can you please introduce yourself to our audience, please? Thank you. Although I've done that.
Okay, yes.
Just say hello.
Hello, hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you loud and clear.
Okay, okay. Thank you very much, Princess, for putting this wonderful program together. I'm honored to be here. As you had previously said, my name is Aloy Ejimako. I'm the special counsel to Mazi Nnamdi Kanu and the indigenous people of Biafra. I'm proudly so. So I'm happy to be here with you as a moderator and as a sister to my client, and with the two co-counsels here to discuss the issues of the day. Thank you so much for having me on.
You're welcome. The next person, please. Prince Mandela, can you introduce yourself?
Thank you very much, Princess. It is my honor and privilege to be in this program. I really appreciate you so much for putting up this great program this morning. It's a wonderful thing to be here and to be honored. Let me say this. I am highly overwhelmed and grateful to my amiable boss and the colleague, Barrister Aloy Ejimako, the rendition man. Thank you. My name is, as earlier stated, Prince Mandela, member of the Nnamdi Kanu team.
You're welcome to the program. Attorney at law, Mr. Athanasios, can you next, please? Can you introduce yourself?
Hello to all of you. Thank you very much for the invitation. I think it's a unique opportunity to discuss all of us together, if it's not possible to meet each other face to face. So I think it's the best solution, and I'm very happy that you invited me to join this meeting and to discuss the case of your brother.
You're welcome. You all are welcome to today's program. And a lot of Biafrans want to know what is going on with Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's case and his extraordinary rendition from Kenya to Nigeria. And now, special counsel, I will start with you.
Okay.
Yes. Before you originated the concept of extraordinary rendition, a lot of people thought that my brother, your client, was legally brought to Nigeria. today, there are still people that don't understand, that don't understand it or its impact on the case. Can you tell us more about it? Thank you.
Yes, thank you. It's very important because the concept of extraordinary rendition is best explained.
Louder, please.
As an opposite to lawful, as an opposite, direct opposite to lawful extradition. You see, this is the scenario. If someone is accused of committing a criminal offense in country A, and the person, for one reason or the other, was able to escape and become a fugitive in country B. If country A is interested in prosecuting that individual, it has to do a number of things. And those things that country A has to do come under the purview of what is called the extradition process. Every country, every civilized nation in the world today has an extradition act or extradition law. Nigeria, which in this very example I'm giving is country A, has an extradition act. Kenya, which in this example is country B, has an extradition act. And these extradition acts are mutual, meaning that when Nigeria goes to Kenya to seek the return, forcible return of a fugitive in which Nigeria has a prosecutorial interest, it has to abide by the extradition act of Kenya. And vice versa, when Kenya comes to Nigeria to seek the return of a Kenyan for prosecution in Kenya, it also has to abide by the provisions of the Nigerian Extradition Act. There's also a little known law that is called the Mutual Legal Assistance in Commonwealth Act. That law has an extraterritorial application. It's a Nigerian law, but it has extraterritorial application in the sense that if Nigeria is interested in the forcible return of any fugitive from any Commonwealth country, it has to abide by the provisions of that law, particularly sections 5 to 7 of that very law. So in the case of Nnamdi Kanu, Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, neither the Kenyan Extradition Act, which is the principal law that is applicable here, was complied with, nor the Mutual Legal Assistance in Commonwealth Countries Act of the federal laws of Federal Republic of Nigeria. None of these two, which are applicable, were complied with. So when that occurs, or when such non-compliance occurs, what the government has done in effect is what is known in common parlance as kidnapping or abduction. It's no different from any one of us coming to your country or your home to kidnap you. The only difference here is that it has been done by a state, and that it has been done by a state does not make it legal. So when the state engages in a conduct where it forcibly takes a fugitive from one country to the other without recourse to the due process of extradition, that state is said to have committed extraordinary rendition, and it comes with consequences, which, if you permit me, I can go on with that, or I can leave the floor for the others to make a contribution, and I can come back to the consequences later. But before then, let me mention a particularly applicable body of law to this very unfortunate situation. It is called the African People and Human African Charter on People and Human Rights. I'm sorry, let me rephrase it. The African Charter on Human and People's Rights. Enforcement and Ratification Act, Laws of Federation of Nigeria, Cap A9. In that very law, the law was written in oracles. Article 12 of that very law, sub 4, Article 12, sub 4, expressly provided that nobody, no Nigerian citizen or even a foreigner, shall be lawfully expelled from country A to country B without recourse to due process of law. That very Article 12 was breached in the circumstances that resulted in bringing Mazi Nnamdi Kanu back to Nigeria. Then you can also go to Chapter 4 of the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, where it is one of the fundamental rights of every Nigerian citizen, and even those who are not Nigerian citizens, but somehow resident in Nigeria, it's a fundamental right that everybody has against arbitrary arrest. So when you take somebody, as they did to Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, forcibly in Kenya, without an extradition order, the arrest is said to be arbitrary. And that offends Chapter 4 of the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. So for those of us out there are a certain segment of the population that believes that the extraordinary rendition we are talking about here was in violation of only international laws and conventions and protocols. No, that is not correct. It's a violation of Nigerian law, the ones I have cited. It's a violation of Kenyan law, where Mazi Nnamdi Kanu was lawfully admitted on a British passport. And of course, it's also a violation of several provisions of international law to which Nigeria is subject. One of them is the Parent Act that brought about the African Charter that was domesticated in Nigeria in 1983. There is a treaty Nigeria ratified in 1979, that has a similar name. It's an African Charter, but it's of the continental kind. Under that treaty, Article 12 of the treaty also made it illegal for member nations to unlawfully expel citizens of one another or of each other without recourse to due process of law. And then you have the United Nations protocols, conventions, and what have you, and other international legal regime that altogether prohibit extraordinary rendition. The legal regime in the international arena has a strict requirement for extradition, not extraordinary rendition. There is no nation on this planet, and there is no rule of law that applies to nations that permits a fugitive to be taken from one country to the other without recourse to the due process of extradition. Thank you.
Thank you so much. You've nailed it. And my question goes to Attorney at Law, Attanasius. I want to ask, because Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, like we know, was tortured in Kenya for 8 days. He was chained to the floor for 8 good days. And I want to ask you, what does EU law say about extraordinary rendition and torture? Can you throw more light on it?
It's very sad that we discuss this issue, because as I was a student at the university, the first thing in international criminal law I have learned is exactly what my good colleague Dr. Edzmako said, that when you want, or you have committed a criminal act, let's say in Germany, and you go from Germany to the Czech Republic, So then Germany, who wants to prosecute it, this criminal act, has to request Czech Republic in an official way the person who is in the Czech Republic to be extradited to Germany. That means a lot of things. First of all, that the person who is in the Czech Republic, for example, has to be, first of all, has to be arrested in a legal way from the authorities, police and state prosecution from in the Czech Republic, not from another state, but another, Germany sends some agents to the Czech Republic to operate there and to arrest the person, but it has to be done from the authorities of the specific country. After that, has to be brought to the judge in order the judge to decide if this person, till the extradition court will take place, will remain in custody or will be released, having, of course, some limitations, restrictions, or to pay a bail or something like that. And after that, a normal extradition court hearing has to take place. And the Czech court has to decide if the person will be sent back to Germany or not. Okay. So then these proceedings are legal proceedings, is according to the law and is according mostly to the Article 6 of the European Convention on Human Rights, okay, which is the fair trial process. This is the guarantee, the maximum quality, which is applied also to this extradition court hearings, okay, proceedings. And also the person, if the person now is in custody, so has to be respected all the rights the person has, because it's not an accused, it's, we still have the presumption of innocence. These proceedings, extradition proceedings, are not proceedings, the normal criminal proceedings, in order to accuse him of a criminal, because this will be done in the other country. It's extradition. Then the person is presumed innocent, so has to have to be in a special prison. It's not a custody, let's say, a premises, not in a normal prison where people who has been accused and have been, of course, sent to serve their sentences and punishments and so on. So, and to have all the rights according also to the European Convention on Human Rights, and of course, according to Article 3, which is that no person should be, is allowed to be treated in a way which is against the human rights. Okay, this is Article 3. This is a special guarantee from the European way. That is to say, not to be tortured, okay? And to be given all the rights a person who is under trial, okay, is not accused, okay, is not convicted, okay, we know that. So then this has to be done according to the internal law, according to the Czech law, let's say, to the Euro, and also according to the European law, which takes priority over the domestic law. And this is the European Convention on Human Rights, and also the European Convention on Extradition, because there is also European Convention on Extradition, how the states will behave if there is such a case. And this is something that is self-understood. It's not something, and that's why I'm very sad that we discuss it now in Nigeria and Kenya, because these are principles that are well known to everybody, not only to people having legal profession, because it is absolutely normal that you have to follow, that you are not allowed to abduct the person. It's absolutely normal that you don't have to kidnap the person from the one country to the other. It's absolutely normal that no agents of the A country will interfere in country B and do things that are not allowed. So this legal then cooperation or legal aid, how we say, between the states, has to be done according to the principles of the domestic law and also of the European law or African law, European Convention, African Convention on Human Rights, and so on. And in our case, it's self-evident that this was not respected. Okay.
Thank you so much for that wonderful explanation. A lot of people who do not know much about extraordinary rendition have been able to digest something from what you have said. Thank you so much. So my next question
is, if you allow me, may I say also something else, something more?
Yeah.
And if you allow me, of course.
Please go ahead.
And we have case law on that. For example, because I teach at the university and I have cases, I transfer this knowledge also and these cases to my students. We have Ocalan case. You know, it's from Kenya to Greece and also to Turkey. Ocalan case, it was a similar case that he was kidnapped. It was the leader of Kurdish people, and he was kidnapped from Kenya.
Yes.
Abducted from Kenya, and differ from Turkish officers. So these are cases that are well known. It's not only the theory, but there are also cases that happened years ago. And these are well known to the legal community, of course, and establish, of course, the right of each person to be treated legally, to be given the rights, procedural rights, okay, in the specific countries, in order the result also to be legal. Because now your brother is not legally treated and tried because there are the procedural obstacles. The court shouldn't try this case if things happened in that way. And this is then annihilated, the whole proceedings is annihilated because it started with a violation of the law. And this was the abduction, the kidnapping. Okay. So we have to go to the source, to what happened in the beginning. Thank you very much. That's all.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for making that very clear. And my next question goes to Mandela, Attorney Mandela. I want to ask you, when did you join, hold on a second, please. Good. I want to ask you, when did you join Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's legal team? Because a lot of people don't know you. Or are you not a fan of social media?
Thank you very much, Princess. You can hear me loud and clear?
I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Can you hear me loud and clear?
I can hear you loud and clear.
That's very good. Okay. Thank you very much. I've been on the ground since 2015 on this Mazi Nnamdi Kanu.
Can you raise your voice a little bit, please?
Issue. Can you hear me?
I can hear you now.
Can you hear me?
I can.
Yes,
go ahead.
Yes. I've been on ground. I've been on ground in this struggle, in this legal battle, since 2015 till that. I am. It's not true, or let me put it this way, that I'm not a fan of social media. The truth is this. I have been doing a lot of work as regards to the struggle, as regards to the liberation, freedom of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu since 2015, started from when he was first arrested down to this particular one he was abducted from Kenya. I am not personally blowing my trumpet, saying every bit of what we do as part of the Mazi Nnamdi Kanu legal team. You can agree with me, Princess, that we work together 2015, 2016, 2017.
You're absolutely right.
I have putting up enough in the legal team. Legally speaking, I have contributed a lot in the struggle for the this just cause of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu legally. So some of us in the legal team, some of us in quotes in the legal team who have chosen to be showcasing themselves every little bit in the social media rather than doing the first priority things to see how Mazi Nnamdi Kanu will be free, regain freedom, get justice. As lawyers, our first priority is to muzzle out every legal arsenal, everything within the confines of the law, to make sure that our clients regain his freedom and get justice. Because, like the two speakers earlier said, he was kidnapped. He was kidnapped from Kenya.
That's right.
It is an abduction. It is in contravention of his mental rights. So in that case, our paramount thing to do, our priority is to fight legally what that can give him justice, what can guarantee his freedom from this illegal arrest, and not campaigning or showcasing ourselves or making ourselves the talk of the event on social media, making ourselves the talk of everything on social media. It's have taken away the job as a lawyer who supposed to be doing everything legally possible within the confines of the law to make sure that his client is being released, is regain his freedom, get justice in the court of law, than every time or every little opportunity some of the lawyers in quotes are always parading themselves on social media without have putting anything reasonable to that will guarantee or that can give assurance that yes, our client is ready to regain his freedom. Because it is what we as lawyers, we the legal team, we the Mazi Nnamdi Kanu lawyers, from what we are doing in court, from the actions we are filing in court, from the legal battles we are doing in court, that will determine, that will guarantee the release of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, not just going about on the social media, showcasing our faces, showcasing our personalities that will release Nnamdi Kanu. Let me say this, even Barrister Aloy Ejimakor, the rendition man, knows what I'm talking about. I've been working assiduously with him, and since 2015 till date. So he knows what I'm talking about, that putting up every legal actions everything priority to make sure that our client, Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, regain his freedom and get justice before the court of law. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you so much, our viewers and our brothers and our brethren and our fans. You have heard what Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's attorney, Prince Mandela, have said. I have actually, we've worked together since 2015 when he was unlawfully incarcerated as well, till date. But a lot of people don't know him. So that was why I decided to throw this question to him. You are welcome once again. My next question.
Thank you very much.
We'll go to Attorney at Law, our EU representative, Mr. Attanasius. Hold on 1 second, please. Good. Sorry, I was unmuting your mic. Have you had any response from the European Union since you filed the case or petitioned them? Thank you.
No, not yet, because the petition was filed a couple of weeks ago. So I think it's very early. I filed it personally also to the High Representative of European Union, Mr. Borrell, it approximately 15 or 16 days ago. So then I'm waiting for an answer or to contact me. I think it's a strong petition. Actually, I sent also the good work there of Mr. Edzimakor in order to show what was filed in Nigeria and also what was filed in Kenya. And it is obvious that this is a clear violation. There is no discussion about that. It's not only one violation, as I said before, but a lot of violations, okay? It's a continuation of violations, starting from the procedural point of view, and of course, from Kenya, then the violations were committed actually in several countries, in Kenya and also in Nigeria. And the violations, of course, affect the African law, the European law. Actually, the petition was filed also in the name of your brother in Germany, who is a German citizen, and also on your behalf, represented, of course, by me. So I think that this is a violation of the laws of the international community. Then it's not only continental violation of Africa, but also European, because such kind of violation actually insult the international community. And as such, should be declared. And in order to protect the human rights, not only of your brother, but also of other people that they suffer. And your brother, of course, is the example in this case, okay? But the international community has to interfere. And such kind of things are not allowed to happen.
Thank you so much. Thank you. My next question goes to the special counsel, Thomas Nnamdi Kanu, Attorney Aloy Ejimakor. Attorney Aloy
Ejimakor. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Vice Counsel, I want to ask whether have you ever argued before a court of law in Nigeria about my brother, your client, Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's extraordinary rendition from Kenya to Nigeria? Yes or no? Because I think that is the key to ensure his release, because any other charges against him is just a formality for them to detain him or keep him in incarceration illegally.
Yes. is a very good question. Like my colleague, Attorney Athanasius said, a lot of violations are present here. And those violations have consequences as a matter of law. And there is no good lawyer that will look at those violations and sweep them under the carpet and do anything other than to bring a countervailing legal action. So I took prompt steps, like my colleague Athanasius pointed out, I took prompt steps to bring a petition before the Continental Tribunal that has jurisdiction, which is the African Commission on Human and People's Rights. I did that as far back as July, that is the month following his rendition in late June. And then I came back here in Nigeria the following month in August. I brought a sui generis, a fresh new legal action standing on its own merit. I filed it before the High Court of Abia State in Nigeria, which under section 46 of Nigerian Constitution is the court that has the jurisdiction, the authority to determine the legal question. Why? Because this extraordinary rendition of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu and the other violations that occurred from 19th June to date did not start today. There's a causal relationship, an unbroken link of causation that started in September 2017 in a place called Afaruku Ibeku in Abia State, Nigeria. And that place is Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's home.
Yes.
The Nigerian Army, together with other security agencies, between the 10th and 14th September 2017, without due process of law, without any legal authority, launched military assault at the home of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu. And the intention was,
that was very correct.
It was to kill somebody. 28 innocent persons died in that attack. Mazi Nnamdi Kanu himself sustained bodily injuries. His parents, late parents, may their souls rest in peace, sustained the traumatic emotional and psychological injuries that are believed to be the remote causes of their demise later in time. But Mazi Nnamdi Kanu was able to make a lucky escape from the hostility, and he managed to make his way overseas, where he got safe haven and became a fugitive. So instead of letting him be, or if the Federal Republic of Nigeria is still interested in prosecuting him.
You're breaking.
Okay. Am I still breaking now?
No, I can hear you now.
Hello?
Hello? You can go ahead.
Hello?
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yeah, hello, can you hear me?
Hello?
Hello, you can go ahead, please. Okay.
No. Go ahead.
Okay, now,
go ahead with the next question.
Mandela, I will continue with you. It looks as if a special counsel is having difficulties in trying to, with his internet. So I will go over to you. When he comes back, we'll pick it up from there. Yeah, Mandela, I want to ask you, how long do you think Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, my brother, will be in detention? Do you have an idea? Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, hello, can you hear me?
Hello?
Yeah, hello?
Hello?
Hello, did you get
hello?
My question?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you now. Go ahead, please.
If I get your question, you said how long will it Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, your brother, how long will be in the if I'm right?
Yes.
Sorry, it was my network. I'm back.
I guess is your question you asked?
Yes, that's what I asked. Wise counsel, I will get back to you.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead. I asked, do you know how long do you think he will remain in detention or incarceration regarding this extraordinary rendition?
Thank you very much, Princess. As lawyer, I might not be here to tell you specifically this is how long Mazi Nnamdi Kanu should stay or be in detention, or to give you a date when Mazi Nnamdi Kanu should be out of the detention. But the as a lawyer, I have to tell you from the legal perspective that as lawyers within the to make sure that he is being released from the detention, first and foremost, we have approached a court which Dr. Aloy Ejimako, the rendition man, had earlier said in his fundamental suit at Umuahia, the High Court of Umuahia. That suit is targeted to release Mazi Nnamdi Kanu from detention. I can tell you that that is the suit that speak volume, that stand the chance of releasing Mazi Nnamdi Kanu from detention, because the suit is all about his illegal arrest, or simply put it, from Kenya, and also his rights that was contravened by the Nigerian security agencies, the military, the police, when he was, you know, attempted to be killed in his hometown, in his house. Since ever then, no suit has been brought before. So, coupled with his abduction from Kenya, a suit was filed by Dr. Aloy Ejimakor in Omar. And from the question you asked, that suit is targeted, is a fundamental right which the court always give serious and the quick attention to. That suit is the suit presently that's hoping to bring Mazi Nnamdi out of this. Like you rightly know that the suit is coming up on 10th of this month, December. So at that date, it is getting to a conclusion to the point where the court will soon be giving his verdict as regards to the issues adumbrated before the court of law. So I can assure you that Mazi Nnamdi Kanu will soon come out of the detention, but I cannot be here to give you specific dates when that will be happen. Let's, as we move on, the issues will be unfolding.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for being honest with us. Thank you so much for enlightening us more that there is no specific date that justice will actually prevail. Thank you. Thank you. Wise Counsel, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. All right. I will go back to our question because it was disrupted. So I will go back to your question again. Like yes. I asked before, I said, have you ever argued before Abuja Court about Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's extraordinary rendition case? From his extraordinary rendition from Kenya to Nigeria, yes or no? Because I think that is the key to his release. Because any other charges that is being leveled against him is just a formality to prolong his illegal detention.
Yes. Can I answer?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear. Go ahead, please.
Okay, yes. I got cut off when I was just about to take that question by the bull. The matter in Abia State, which Barrister Mandela has explained very succinctly, is targeted at the prosecution of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu. Extraordinary rendition, as Attorney Athanasius will agree with me, creates a barrier to prosecution. It creates a barrier to prosecution. You cannot profit from your own wrong. The prosecutor is not allowed to rendition, or the prosecution is not allowed to put on trial or to prosecute a fugitive that the prosecutor renditioned. If, as a prosecutor, you're interested in prosecuting a fugitive that you found in a foreign country, you have to subject him first to the process of extradition. That is the only way you can preserve your authority to prosecute that fugitive or that accused person. But in this very case of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, it was rendition. Therefore, that rendition has defeated the prosecutorial authority of the Federal Republic of Nigeria or the Attorney General to put him on trial. And this is not legal theory. This has been done in practice. We have a host of case laws. Even though extraordinary rendition is a matter of first impression in Nigeria, we have pertinent case laws from within Commonwealth countries and outside of it, to which the Nigerian court can look to for guidance. We have one from the UK, many of them, but I'm going to give you one. It's called R versus Hesse's Magistrate Court, Ex parte Bennett. In that very case, a certain individual was renditioned from New Zealand, I think. But the court, the Supreme Court of England, held ultimately that because he wasn't subjected to the process of extradition, and but was brought into England through the process of extraordinary rendition or unlawful expulsion, his prosecution could not go on. Then you have the matter of Ibrahim, a case of a man that was renditioned from Swaziland to South Africa. I think that was in 1990. The prosecution of Ibrahim was also defeated by the sheer fact of his extraordinary rendition. Then we have cases from New Zealand and Australia, in which case the courts held that extraordinary rendition is an abuse of the legal process, or is so much of a fundamental abuse of the human rights of the individual that the prosecutor can no longer put that person to trial. The sense in all of these things is that if you really want to put that person to trial, maybe what you should do is to repatriate him back to his place of domicile and file for extradition. But you see, even in Nigeria, or as respects Nigeria, Nigeria has learned several lessons with extraordinary rendition that it should know not to commit it. In 1984, Nigeria attempted to rendition an individual called Omar Odigo. I think he's late now. They kidnapped him in UK and put him in a crate and tried to smuggle him out of Heathrow Airport. They sedated him, put him in a crate, and tried to smuggle him as a diplomatic baggage. But a vigilant British intelligence officer spotted the anomaly and thwarted that illegal rendition. What did Britain do? Britain arrested 17 persons who were either directly or indirectly connected with this attempted rendition.
Yeah.
Four of them were convicted as being clearly complicit and imprisoned to between 6 to 8 years imprisonment in UK, and they were ultimately deported. The Nigerian aircraft that was going to be used as the vessel for the rendition was interdicted in UK. The pilot was nearly arrested, but he made a lucky escape. Almost all the diplomatic staff, Nigerian diplomatic staff in Britain, were expelled. And Britain severed diplomatic relations with Nigeria for 2 years, all because of this attempted rendition of Omar Odigo. And Omar Odigo was not even a British citizen. He was merely a resident. But Britain rose to the occasion. As recently as 2 months ago, the American government has shown interest in a top police officer in Nigeria, and there was a warrant of arrest for that police officer issued by a U.S. court. What did America do? A powerful nation like America, they came in here into Nigeria and filed for extradition of that police officer. They didn't come here fly by night, in the middle of night, and steal him away or kidnap him or abduct him. America has the wherewithal, the capacity to abduct anybody. More capacity than Nigeria. But they didn't do that. They came here and filed processes in our courts. Nigeria also is filing processes before the Benin Noise Court, the courts of Benin Republic next door to Nigeria, for the extradition of Sunday Adeyemo to Nigeria. They didn't just go there to abduct him and rendition him like they rendition Kanu. So Nigeria itself is well aware of the consequences of the action or its misconduct towards Mazi Nnamdi Kanu. But as Barrister Mandela said, these things will play out in court, and we'll see where the gavel will fall. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. But I want to know, this extraordinary rendition, have you argued this in Abuja?
Yes. Yes, the process was filed. I contributed to the process. You know, I'm not the attorney of record in the Abuja case, so I probably have some limited wiggle room in terms of what I can get going in that case. But ultimately, an application was filed challenging the jurisdiction of the court to proceed with the trial based on this extraordinary rendition. The argument before the court, to which I made contributions, is that the trial of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu can no longer legally proceed within the framework of the extraordinary rendition that was visited upon him. That is the argument. Very simple. It's very similar to the argument that is before the court in Umuahia. But you know, the Abia State High Court case is targeting the prosecution. The argument in court, in the Abuja court, is targeting the court itself. So the argument is that the court cannot have jurisdiction, or the jurisdiction of the court has been defeated by this extraordinary rendition, that before you can properly bring a suspect, an accused person, before a court from a foreign nation, the process that would have given that court jurisdiction is the process of extradition, not rendition. Rendition detracts or defeats the jurisdiction of the court. That is the argument before the Abuja court. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much for that, for that clarity. And my next question goes to Attorney Abnesius. Have you ever considered, hold on a second, let me unmute you. Yes, my next question goes to Attorney Ignatius. I want to ask you, have you ever considered going to Nigeria to visit your client, Mazi Nnamdi Kanu? Because the way things are going, I don't know how long he will be incarcerated.
Okay, first of all, let's hope and pray your brother to be released soon. This should have happened even earlier, but I think this is what my good colleague said before. It's a struggle, because as you understand, and all of us understand, this violation is a severe one, what happened, and this makes the whole proceedings invalid in Nigeria, because if the first action, the abduction, was done in an illegal way, or the transfer of your brother from Kenya to Nigeria in an illegal way, and this is what my good colleague Dr. Izimakor said before, you cannot profit from your own wrong, yeah, or from your own illegal action, so then the proceedings in Nigeria are invalid, okay, invalid because of this violation. So that's why I say that your brother should have been released in the beginning, immediately, but I understand that most probably the court system there, or I don't know what's going on. Sometimes, you know, it's difficult to understand it. Let's hope that this will be done soon. Now, if this is not done soon, of course I would be interested to visit him. And now, of course, there are some restrictions because of COVID. You know, the situation is very, it's changing from day to day. But if I see that this situation is continuous, then it's of course within my plans to go and to meet him actually for the first time face to face, and to discuss further, even to meet my good colleagues in Nigeria who are doing a great job there.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that enlightenment. Thank you. My next question will go to Dr. Aloy Ejimako. Apart from your role as a special counsel in Abuja case, what other steps have you taken towards seeking justice for Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, the leader of IPOB?
Okay, well, I can count them on my fingers.
Please go for it.
The lawsuit in Abia State is one.
Yes.
The one before the African Commission on Human and People's Rights is two. And I had the privilege and opportunity of assisting your older brother, Canon Takano, who resides in Germany.
Yeah.
I had the honor and privilege of assisting him in his engagements with the Bindman's law firm in UK.
In the
actions and processes they brought before the United Nations. And as you know, that very action they took yielded something that is called a request for urgent action. It was issued on 27th August, but because of the 60 days confidentiality requirement of the United Nations, it was not disclosed until the 26th of October.
Yeah.
So that very engagement produced something in the form of an urgent action. In common parlance, you can call it a query, which the United Nations Special Rapporteurs on Human Rights issued to Nigeria and Kenya. And that one is awaiting response from these two countries. So these three are the three main engagements, legal or judicial, that I have been involved in. I have also had the privilege of engaging the British High Commission here in Nigeria from the get-go. My first letter to them went out on 30th June. That was a day after Mazi Nnamdi Kanu was presented in court in Abuja on 29 June. The following day, I sent a letter by email, electronic mail, to the embassy, to the High Commission, and they responded within 5 days. And since then, I've been engaged and with the embassy, with the High Commission, in activities geared towards garnering consular intervention, British consular intervention for Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, who, as you know, is a citizen or a national of the United Kingdom.
Yes.
Yes, so in these engagements, legal arguments have been made, particularly the one that I made to the British authorities is the one under some kind of international convention that required Kenya, if Kenya is complicit, is denying that it is, but assuming that it is complicit, Nnamdi Kanu should have been treated as a national of UK, United Kingdom, not of Nigeria, when he was discovered in Kenya, because he arrived in Kenya on his British passport. So throughout his stay in Kenya, he was Her Majesty's subject under the protection of the Kenyan government. So that argument has been made by me to the British authorities, and I think the Bindmans in the UK made similar arguments to the Home Office. So I do believe that some progress is being made, even though it's slow. And of course, you have the other one in Kenya being pursued by the Lucris of Kenya. Lucri Associates is a top law firm in Kenya. They have filed legal actions before the Kenyan High Court, and that legal action has brought so many revelations. Kenyan government for the first time outside of newspaper publications made admissions on the record before the court that Mazi Nnamdi Kanu did not undergo any extradition, repatriation, or deportation proceedings in Kenya, thus confirming finally that he was abducted or kidnapped in violation of the laws of Kenya. So this so far are the engagements in which I'm involved. And of course, I have a principal role I'm playing in the Abuja case, which takes me to Abuja often and on. Thank you. Thank you. Hello? Hello? Hello?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, but it looks like you can't hear me.
I can hear you now. Sorry, I mistakenly unmute my this thing. Mute my mic, yes.
Okay, where did I stop? I stopped at Kenya or something. Where did I stop?
Yes. You stopped. You've been able to give us some a specific clarity and explanation on apart from your role as the wise counsel in Abuja case, the things that you have done to be able to make sure that Mazi Nnamdi Kanu gets justice.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you so much for throwing more light on that.
Thank you.
I know that this has been in the mind of a lot of Biafrans. A lot of people cannot reach you. I'm sure that the questions that I'm asking today, I am speaking the mind of a lot of people. And I am grateful and honored to have you on this very show. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you so much. My next question goes to Mandela.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. My next question goes to Mandela. Mandela, I am surprised that the media was allowed in court because since the inception of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's extraordinary rendition, they don't allow the media to come close, they don't allow people to come to the court. But this last one that happened on the 2nd of December, if I'm not mistaken, I was surprised to see media in court, although he was not present. So I want to, unlike his previous case, so I want to know your advice to the court on the next proceeding. Hello, can you hear me?
Hello, yes, Princess, I can hear you. I can hear you now.
Yeah, can you raise your voice a little bit, please, your voice?
Okay. Can you hear me loud and clear right now?
Yes, I can. Go ahead.
Okay. Like you rightly said, during the previous sittings of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu case, the media and lawyers were barred from entering into the courtroom or having access to courtroom.
Absolutely.
But the last court sitting, which was conducted on the 2nd of December, 2021, it was not so. Medias were in that very day. I can vividly tell you that a lot of media even walked into the courtroom that very day, and many of them were beside, or in fact, they gained access into the court premises, entered into the courts. Many of them, and some of them, were outside the
inside the courtroom, but not outside the court premises. They can access inside the court premises to show that that very day, as media came in, we are allowed in. It did not any havoc. It did not cause any trouble. The courtroom were not put down. No strange thing happens. That is how it's supposed to be, because this is not a secret trial or where you can stop the medias from, you know, coming in into the courts or into the court premises to take records of the court proceedings or what actually is going on. Like stopping lawyers. Most of the lawyers who came in solidarity of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, like previous case, will always stop from gaining access into the court premises, not to talk about entering into the courtroom. They will first stop from the gates, from in fact 2 meters from the gates, coming close to the court's premises. But unlike but the last court sitting wasn't like that. What am I trying to say? As they allowed lawyers and medias the last court sitting, it did not bring down the court building. It did not cause any violence
at all.
Rather, it promotes the transparency and legally, constitutionally guaranteed rights of anyone who is facing trial. The medias under the Chapter 4 of the 1999 Constitution has what is called the freedom of the press.
Yes.
So when you stop the media from taking, doing their duty as guaranteed by the the Constitution, that is in violation of their rights, and also is a violation of the suspect or the person standing a trial, and also stopping lawyers who directly, the Nnamdi Kanu lawyers or those who come in solidarity to Nnamdi Kanu's case, stopping them is also a violation of his rights, because an accused person, there is no limitation of lawyers which an accused person can engage in his case. So if lawyers comes for Nnamdi Kanu's case and is being stopped, they are being stopped from getting access into the courtroom, that is a violation of the their rights. So I can, my advice to the courts, or rather even the Attorney General of the Federation, is to make sure that the writing is being done. They should give unfettered access to lawyers, to medias, since they are working within the confines of the law. They are not supposed to be stopped from getting access into the courts. So from what happened last or 2nd of December shows that if they were allowed into the courts, if lawyers were allowed to attend their the courts, is has no it has no negative effects on the courts. Rather, it will now speak that yes, the court is being transparent in the.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Because it is appalling that lawyers will be refused access to the court. I have never had such a thing before. I am so shocked when I saw those things. When I saw the thing was everywhere, it was on every platform in the media. A lot of media houses too carried it. I was wondering what is going on. Is it out of negligence, or is it out of wickedness, or I don't get it, or are they trying to be to isolate him because he's an Ibo Biafran? I don't get it. But all the same, I am glad that we have that he has people like this great and wonderful team of lawyers who knows what time is it. So all I need to do is go look for trouble. I have people to back me up. Okay, my next question goes to Attorney Atnesius. Is there anything you are doing that will help facilitate the release of your client, my brother, Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, the leader of Ipob in European Union, at least to make the Nigerian government to release him, because extraordinary rendition is a crime?
As I have told you before, it has to be put pressure on the European Union, on the High Representative of European Union, on these external services of European Union. Of course, your brother is a UK citizen. UK, unfortunately, is not a member of European Union. But even though families and members of his family, like your brother, is a German citizen. So this is the reason why we filed this petition to the EU High Representative and to the European Commission, in order to bring to the attention of European Union the issue of your brother, which is a recent issue. Although it happened in Africa, doesn't matter. This is a violation of international law. It's a violation of European law. The principles are the same, okay? There are no African principles, procedural or criminal principles, or European. These are international principles. Then if something wrong, illegal happens in Africa, it's also an insulting, how to put it, it's violating also the international law. So this has to be brought to the attention, and this has been already done, of European Union. Of course, we have, if they don't react, we have to insist. This is extremely important, to put this pressure. So European Union, don't forget that, is reacting now to what happened in Burma, when the leader there, the democratic leader, was convicted to 4 years imprisonment. This happened yesterday, 2 days ago. So it's reacting also when something happens in Asia, or something happens in Pakistan or Afghanistan, wherever in the world. So why not now also, what happened in Africa? So the European Union is not only for, or the High Representative. High Representative is the Minister, let's say, of Foreign Affairs of European Union. Then it's not limited to react also in that case, because these violations are violations of international law. Okay, so then this is extremely important. As you know, this kind of pressure from European Union, from UK, from other countries, is extremely important also for the trial in Nigeria, in order the Nigerian court, the Nigerian government, not to feel that it's alone and can do whatever they want, okay? Because this has to be brought to the eyes of the international community. And as my good colleague said before, my colleagues, that A fair trial process, also according to Article 6 of the European Convention on Human Rights, should be public process, public, okay, and open proceedings, not closed proceedings. Media should be there, people should go there, because the public and also the media, they show, they control that what is done in this courtroom is done properly and according to the laws of the country, according to the procedural laws, and this is a fair trial, not behind closed doors and not opened to the international community, to the local community there, to the media. This is extremely important. Okay, so then all these things should have happen, and all of us, me, my good colleagues in Nigeria, we put something, okay, something positive in order to achieve what? Your brother to be released, to be given a fair trial, and also the Nigerian, the judges and the government to understand that this is not, they cannot do or they cannot have profit from their own illegal actions, as my good colleague Dr. Etzimakor said before. Okay, this is extremely important.
Thank you so much. And this is really, really mind-blowing. Thank you.
I want to say something quickly because my battery is very low. It's hardly like 12%. So I can make my final contribution and then see how I can charge the battery up.
Okay. My next question goes to you, though.
Okay.
As an attorney in Nigeria, do you need any help from European Union to assist you in securing the release of your client, Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, who was forcefully renditioned to Nigeria from Kenya?
Yes. As my colleague, Attorney Athanasius, has said, the opinion of the European Union will count illegally and diplomatically. He cited the example of Burma and what has been happening in other places around the world where the European Union would ordinarily have an opinion. So why shouldn't the European Union have an opinion on this? If the opinion is judicial or quasi-judicial, it will count in influencing the direction of decisions being taken in Nigeria here, either executive or judicial decisions. If the opinion is diplomatic, it will also count. Yes, what Attorney Athanasius is doing is very critical, is very important. I will encourage him to continue to do so because rights are rights, whether those rights are violated in Europe or in Africa. The rights are very similar. The European, the African Convention on Human and People's Rights, or the Charter itself, is a direct mirror of the European Convention on Human and People's Rights as well. So these rights are similar. That we are Africans, or that the government is dealing with an African person, does not translate or amount to the absence of these rights. So it will be very easy for the European Union to understand that rights have been violated here, as Attorney Athanasius has put before them. And if he takes a decision to intervene, either diplomatically or otherwise, it will be highly helpful here in Nigeria in securing the release of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu or securing justice for him. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know. I still have more questions for you, but I don't know
why you can throw, you can ask me. My battery is about 7 or 8%. I can take 2 more questions very quickly.
Okay. Let me go straight to the point then. Before you go out.
Mm-hmm.
You originated extraordinary rendition in Nigeria.
Mm-hmm.
And Athanasios is in charge of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's extraordinary rendition in EU. Could you please define the role of Bruce Fine and make it clear? Is he a part of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's legal team?
Well, what I can comment on is what I'm privy to. I am privy to, officially, I'm privy to the activities or participation of the Lucri of Kenya, the Bindemans of UK, and I'm now privy to the participation of Attorney Athanasios.
Yeah.
And also privy to the participation on the legal team in Nigeria here. I've seen Attorney Bruce Fine in Nigeria a couple of times. It's my speculation, I don't have the details, that someone might have sent him from America over this matter, but I don't have any information more than what I'm telling you here. Bruce Fine is my friend. I have known him for the past 25 years.
Okay.
We had done a few legal briefs together in the past. I know him very well, but he did not come into the case through my contacts, or I didn't contact him on it. But I saw him in Nigeria, and I believe someone might have sent him here to try to do one or two things in relation to the case. That's the best I can tell you on this.
Okay, thank you so much. It's been most informative. And I have one more question for you before you go.
Go ahead.
We have had you argue in your write-ups that Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, the leader of IPOB, has committed no crime. Can you shed more light on this?
Yes. What I mean by that is that self-determination is not a crime in any country. Domestically and internationally, it's not a crime. In Nigeria itself, that is now seeking to punish it as a crime, is not a crime under Article 20 of Laws of Federation of Nigeria, Cap A9, is not a crime. That very article provides that all peoples shall have the inalienable right to self-determination, and that the government of the day shall do whatever it can not to suppress that right. And under the Nigerian Constitution, self-determination is considered a political opinion. So that it is a political opinion that is inconvenient or not well-liked or well-regarded by the government of the day does not make it a crime. Under Section 36, subsection 12 of Nigerian Constitution, nothing is a crime if it is not written and defined in a written law in Nigeria. There's no law in Nigeria that defines self-determination or even secession as a crime. But you see, when you look at the case of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, every criminal allegation that has been leveled against him have roots or relationship to the enterprise in which he's engaged, which is the enterprise of self-determination. So what I think is happening here is that Nigerian government regards self-determination as a political opinion that should be punished or suppressed by means of punishment of some sort. So it doesn't make it a crime, but you see, we have not even gotten to that. It is only when the court has jurisdiction or the prosecutor succeeds in protecting his prosecutorial authority to go forward with the case, then we make that case that these charges are incompetent. That is probably why they skated around, they avoided the process of extradition in Kenya. Because under Kenyan Extradition Act, self-determination is considered a political opinion, or what is called the political offense exception. So under Kenyan Extradition Act, no court in Kenya would have extradited Mazi Nnamdi Kanu to Nigeria to be tried for any offense relating to self-determination. I think this was the reason, the motivation for going around the laws of Kenya to try to split him secretly to Nigeria through a process of extraordinary rendition. So it's a political opinion that is not a crime. Yes, it's not. It's not at all. And there's nobody in Nigeria that has been successfully prosecuted and convicted for possessing that political opinion of self-determination.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. My next question goes to Attorney Agnesius. Can you define what EU law says about extraordinary rendition? Or is it illegal for one European country to go to another European country and kidnap a fugitive for trial?
I have already answered this question in the very beginning. As I told you, there is a European Act on cooperation between the countries on extradition. This is since 1957, and there are several bilateral agreements between European countries. There is also the Schengen Convention. How then, if we have such a case, as I named in the beginning, somebody from Germany goes to the Czech Republic, commits a criminal act in Germany, goes to another country, like for example, in the Czech Republic. So then it has to be an official extradition a request from Germany to the Czech Republic. Then the requested country has bring the person, first of all, legally to arrest the person, to bring it to the judge to decide if this person will be released on bail or will be remain in detention. And after that, a normal court hearing, then the Germany has to send the file and what are the accusations to the Czech court, and the Czech court has to bring the person a fair trial and to see also what my good colleague said before, we have the double criminality, if what is criminal in Germany is also criminal in the Czech Republic. This is also another very important prerequisite in order to, if it's not criminal in the Czech Republic, then the person will not be extradited also to Germany. And also just a very interesting example to give you about self-determination. If you remember, we had the case in Spain, in Catalonia, where they had a referendum there, Catalonia to become in Spain a separate state. Okay, and the leader of Catalonian parliament, Puigdemont, Mr. left to Belgium, and Spain requested Belgium to extradite him to Spain in order to be tried there, and Belgium said no. Okay, because also of this double criminality, because there was not a crime, actually. Okay, and Mr. Puigdemont from Belgium went to a conference in Italy. This happened 1 month ago. And Spain requested Italy to extradite him to Spain. And also Italian court released him. Okay, then you see how civilized countries between them, they do that. You have a financial, nobody came from Spain to an agent to abduct him from Belgium or from Italy to bring him to Spain and to judge him there for that he's a separatist or a terrorist or whatever. And unfortunately, some states, they cover it. They say, okay, if it's not a crime, they say he's a terrorist. Okay. But because, you know, you have the right to gather, to say your political opinion, to express your opinion in a peaceful way and so on. So this is a human right. Okay, this is a human right, even peacefully to gather, to say your opinion, okay, you are not a terrorist, okay, that you act with arms and guns, whatever. So this is a culture. This is the culture, the political culture, the respect of human rights. So this is how it should happen, then according to the law, everything according to the law. And if there is a crime, as my good colleague Dr. Etzimakos said, it has to be defined specifically in the law. Crime is not abstract, because if it was abstract, everybody could be accused. It should be written in the law specifically. Nullum crimen, nulla pene sine lege certa. You have to have the specific law, okay, describing the crime, in order to avoid dictatorship. Okay, to avoid this, because everybody could be accused and convicted according to abstract things. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for such an eye-opening explanation. Thank you so much for that. And I have another one for you, Attorney Attanasius. What will, in the case of Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, what will an European court do in circumstances of a country kidnapping a citizen fugitive without going through the extradition process?
Yes, here in Europe,
yeah,
we have the European Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg. So if we had a similar case, so the European Court in Strasbourg would say that this is a clear violation of several articles of the European Convention. First, the Article 6 of the European, your brother was not given a fair trial. Secondly, Article 5 of the European Convention on Human Rights, your brother is illegally, unlawfully in detention for now a long time. This is Article 5. Nobody should be detained without, in detention without a reason. Okay, and also Article 3 of the European Convention. This is the torture. Everybody should be have a fair treatment, even in prison, to be given access to his lawyers, to be given access to people, to visit him, family members. Okay, then this is extremely important, and this didn't happen. Okay, this is a violation, and also Article 2, right to life. Okay, this is extremely important because also his life is in danger. So these are clear violation of the European Convention on Human Rights. I suppose the same articles exist also in the European Convention of People Rights in Africa, in every continent, actually. So these are clear, these are the similar principles. These principles are assimilated. There is no human right, European and human and African human right. One is the human right. It belongs to everybody. I come from Greece, or I am in the Czech Republic, or Africa, then all of us, we have the same rights. Fair trial, to be not to be detained without a reason, okay? Not to be tortured, okay? To be given access to lawyers, to family members to visit, and more to that, your brother is presumed innocent. He's not a convicted person. If he was a convicted person, okay, the situation is different, but he's an innocent now in prison, okay, in detention.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then these are clear violations, and of course these violations also would be convicted or would be stated also in a court here, in the European Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg.
Yes. Yeah, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Yes, Mandela, this is going to be your last question. As MNK attorney, who sees him on a regular basis, do you tell him the truth of what is happening on social media? Or are you biased? For instance, Omuwai Highway, all these Nelly and Co groups and other groups that is trying everything within their reach to make sure that IPOP is divided by giving people negative impressions that Biafra is a Portuguese name, is no longer Biafra, is now Edo Kingdom. What effort have you made to let him, enlighten him, since he doesn't have access to media where he is? He cannot communicate with the outside world. You are the eye that he uses to see the outside. Can you, what did you, were you able to give him some sense of clarity on what is going on? That's what I want to ask. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think he's having difficulties or technical hitch or no. His internet. Hello, can you hear me? Hello, you are breaking. I can hear you a little bit, but you're breaking.
Hello?
Yeah, hello. Welcome back.
Yes. I always bring to his notice what is actually going on in social media concerning issues at hand. I've never put anything hidden to him. I put issue threats as it is on social media to him.
Yeah.
Because yes. I believe so much that we are the ones as lawyers who directly sees him every week. If we cannot tell him the truth, how it is, it means we are not doing justice to our client. We must tell him the truth the way it is. Because, like Nelly, you mentioned, it is because we are telling our client and Mazi Nnamdi Kanu the truth. I personally tell him all the issues arising from Nelly, or he has how she has been going about to fuel or form crisis since Nnamdi Kanu was kidnapped. I personally bring to his notice, and I think it was what led from also what, like, special counsel Barrister Aloy Ejimakor also bringing to his notice concerning the issues of how people are going about tarnishing the image of lawyers, especially this particular woman you mentioned, Nelly, has been on social media talking a lot of what is ordinarily not supposed to be said against the Nnamdi Kanu lawyers. Most especially is directly attacking Mr. Aloy Ejimakor, who has put in enough, who has been judging his duty as a lawyer. So when we bring all these things to the Mazi Nnamdi Kanu notice, that led to this expulsion of Nelly as an IPOB member. Because if I personally, who sees Nnamdi Kanu, cannot tell him the truth, I don't think I am doing justice to him, because he has no access, he cannot know what is happening in social media since his incarceration. So it is our duty as his lawyers to tell him the truth, which I do. And I can tell you confidently that I will continue in telling him the truth of everything that is going around on the social media. And being a man he is, and a very pragmatic leader of if I determine to, you know, tackle issues
and yes,
take very diligent decisions that will not only maintain the goals of the IPOB, but to stabilize and IPOB in one family. And that is our duty as lawyer.
Yes.
And I personally, I will continue to tell him the truth.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
For telling him the truth. My next question goes to Ignatius, and this is it's not his last. It's not your last. My next question goes to you. Does such a person kidnapped have the right to sue in court for remedies?
Okay.
No, I'll come again. Did you hear me?
I heard you. It's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, of course. Of course, he can issue the state for remedies. Yes, if there is an illegal action. An illegal action is according to the international law. Then the state acted illegally. The state is, we don't have a person here. We don't have a legal entity, a company, but the state is also a legal entity. Okay, then the state, if we have an illegal action and you have suffered, you have been in prison, okay, in detention for several months, then you have been not given a fair trial and all other rights, then your personal life suffered, you were not able to go back to UK to continue your work, whatever. All this, how we say, material and immaterial damages you have suffered, then, of course, you can file a remedy against the state. Of course, this should be filed if, for example, Nigeria is the state, or Germany, let's say, in Europe, or just to have an example, the one I mentioned to you before, then because the state has immunity, you cannot file this in another state in the Czech Republic, then you have to file it in Germany, then before a German court, and to ask for remedies. Okay. So this is... this is according to the law, and even sometimes the European Court of Human Rights, when states that there are some violations of the European Convention, then also puts an obligation to the state to pay some damages. Of course, these are symbolic damages, but after that, the person can file a claim also in the specific state who has committed the violation.
Yes.
This is according to the law.
Okay, thank you so much. This is your last question. What is EU's position on self-determination?
Okay, I mentioned before the example from Spain, okay, about Catalonia. This is one case which happened some years ago. You know, as I told you in the past, before, that to have your own opinion, yes, and political opinion, this doesn't make you a terrorist. Okay, this is for sure. So, of course, if you try just to put your opinion in a way, like, for example, to put people together, to fight with arms and so, this is something different. But if you peacefully, you organize such a movement, like it was the case of Catalonia, and also a referendum, a legal referendum, in order the people to vote if they want to be as Spain or if they want to live as Catalonia,
yeah.
This is not a crime. Okay, this is not a crime. It's another thing, of course, if the state as such tries to present it in a different way, that it's not a peaceful movement, but these people are terrorists. They want to do it in a secret way with arms and guns and so on. But this is, you know, how the state might present that. In the reality, if you move in a peaceful way, or to have some demonstration or gatherings, which is your right according to the law, and even according to the European law, the European Convention, you have the right to people to come together or to have an association, which association will actually promote the idea and an opinion that this region or the people of the region would like to live separately, but they have to do it, of course, in a legal way, like a referendum or whatever. So this is not a crime. So and then actually the European Union, such kind of peaceful movements, does not consider or do not consider it as a crime. Oh, no. But sometimes, you know, the states, because they are afraid of this kind of movement, they try to present it in a different way. Okay, and this was exactly the case of Catalonia. We had this in EU, but Belgium protected the leader, and also Italy protected the leader, because there was no criminality there. There was no criminal action. So why to extradite him if there is not a crime? Okay.
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
No.
Mandela, I will give you 2 minutes to summarize on this extraordinary rendition. To summarize it for today, just 2 minutes. Hello? Hello?
Can you hear me?
I can hear
Hello,
you now.
Can you hear me? Your mute?
Okay. I can hear you now.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. That's very good. Mm-hmm. Like my colleagues had rightly said, this Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, I want to put it straight that Mazi Nnamdi Kanu was kidnapped, unlawfully arrested. Hello, can you hear me right? Can you hear me clear now?
Yeah, I can hear you now, but you're breaking. Your internet is not very okay.
Hello?
Yeah, hello, I can hear you now.
Hello?
Hello, can you
okay.
hear me?
Can you hear me clear now? Right now?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Yes, yeah. Yes, I can hear you loud and clear.
Okay, can go ahead. Yes, go ahead then.
Okay. Like I was saying before,
Hello?
Extraordinary renditions. Balance, it is he was unlawfully arrested, he was kidnapped, he was abducted from Kenya and brought down to Nigeria, and that is what makes its trial here in Nigeria unconstitutional, because
wow,
the incapacity and expect it to stand.
giving so much problem.
Hello?
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 Hello, can you hear me?
Hello? Can you hear me?
Hello? Okay, he's having a technical hitch, so I don't know, I don't think we can continue. I want to say thank you all. You've been fantastic. You've been outstanding. I can't thank you enough for all your collective effort in making sure that justice prevails over Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's extraordinary rendition. I want to say keep it up, continue, and thank you so very much. Thank you, and bye. Thank you. Thank you, bye.